Hi folks, this is Nikhil and you are learning GoLang with me. In this particular session, I'm going to talk about the most important aspect of today's programming language, and that aspect is function. In the old era, in 80s and 90s, few decades back, when there was BASIC and other programming languages, people used to write the code in a single file, and there used to be go to instructions in the file, and after executing certain logic there used to be a go to or let's say go to line number 10, 15, like that, and then that go to used to instruct the compiler or interpreter to actually go to that particular line in the instruction and then start executing the code from there. To be precise, there was no such structure that exists today. So the modularization part or the structured programming model came later as people realized that as the code becomes large, as you start adding lot of logic in a single file, then it's very difficult and very tedious job to maintain such code base or such code files. And that's how the procedural languages came, then the object oriented languages came. So the entire focus is on the structured programming language, having that modularization, having the modules and so on. So in GoLang, the structured modules, or let's say the modularization, is provided with the help of the package and the function. So in this session I'm going to talk about the function, and then in the next session I'll be focusing on the package. So in GoLang, the function signature is like this. So you have the func, which is the keyword, then the next part is the receiver. The receiver is something that is not there in other programming languages such as Java and Scala, for example, the GVM based languages. So I will be talking about receiver later on. So let's focus on the function as of now, the simple function, and then the function that takes the input parameters and then returns the values to the caller. So you have the receiver, then after the receiver you have the identifier, or let's say this is the function name. After the function name you have the set of the input parameters, so input parameters, and then you have the return parameters. So if you don't have the input parameters, then simply you say func and function name and input, let's say starting curly bracket regular one and closing curly bracket, opening and closing curly bracket regular ones, and then there is no return, and then you start with the again the different curly bracket and then the closing curly bracket. So this is the regular bracket and this is the curly bracket, right? So that's how the functions are defined in GoLang. Now if you just open any of the IDE, especially the GoLang IDE, then you will find that automatically there is a default function, that is function main, that does not accept the parameters, that does not return anything. So this is the default function. And then let's start with the customized function. So let's say we want to define a simple function hello world, and then you start with the function, name of the function, no input parameter, no return parameter, open the curly bracket, and then just say that format println welcome to the GoLang world, and then the closing curly bracket. So that actually defines the scope of the function, which is limited to the package main. Now if I just run it without calling it, then nothing will happen. But if I just add the invocation, which is also known as calling a function from the other function, then you will see that once the main is executed, let's keep it as a first instruction to the program. So when the main is executed, then the first thing that it does is it calls the hello world. Let's execute this program. So you'll see that welcome to the GoLang world. So this is getting displayed. So this is about the simple function, the function that does not accept or that does not take the input parameters and that does not return any value to the caller. Caller is the main over here, because from main we are calling the hello world function. The next function is a function sum with two parameters x and y, and it returns the sum of x plus y, x and y. The sum x plus y is a single value that is being returned to the caller function. So in order to do so, I am defining x and y as 10. Let's say this is 20. So now I do believe that you recollect the shorthand operator. So you have x and y, and then you call the sum, you pass the x and y, and you store the result into sum result. Again, it is a shorthand operator. You can declare var sum result in, and then you don't have to make use of the shorthand operator. Now over here, in this particular call or in this particular instruction, the x and y are known as the arguments, right? And when it comes to the sum function, then the x int and y int, the x and y are called as the input parameters. I wanna return int, so I will have the return type as int, so it goes into the other bracket. I start my function, I say that sum is equal to x plus y. Again, sum over here is declared without having the prior declaration of var sum int, so that's why the shorthand operator. I will say that just for the let me remove that for the clarity, and then I'm just saying that return sum, and then I'm storing sum value into sum result. Now over here, the x and y are getting passed as passed by value. It's very important to understand that over here the x and y arguments are getting passed to the sum function as passed by value. Simple as it is. You might have some understanding about pass by value, pass by reference, copy by value, something like that, but then in this particular example, when we have the simple parameters that are getting passed to the function, then these are called as the arguments, and arguments are in this case getting passed as passed by value, and then I'm printing the sum result. So you can see that now the sum should be 30. So so sum of the two numbers x and y is 30. Now going to the next level, now this was the example that actually depicts the return of one value, but what about the fact that most of the times you might want to return more than one value to the caller? Now in functions such as Java, you don't have that facility, and that's why generally what you do is, if you wanna pass the more than one value to the caller, so as a part of the return statement, you declare the array. In the array you store the values, let's say index 0, index 1, index 2, and then in the caller function you get an array, and then you expand that array, or let's say you look to that particular index, and then you store the result into the variable. However, in GoLang there is a very good feature that let you make use of the return like this. So it's kind of the tuple that you can pass. By the way, you can pass n number of values to the caller. So you can say that this is bool, this is bool, this is string, this is int, something like that. I will showcase that example later on. So you define a function that takes two parameters and returns two returns two values, not parameters. So let's say this is sort numbers function. I take x and y. I return first number which is greater in counting, and then second number which is less than the first. So I declare two variables, first number, second number. I compare the numbers x and y, and then I store the result x, y, y, x. So over here x is greater than y, over here y is greater than x, and then I return two integers, first number and second number, as simple as it looks. In the caller, I just declare first and second on the left hand side. These are the variables. I invoke a function that returns two integers, and then automatically the results are being stored in first and second in the order in which the in which the values are returned. So if I just run it, so let's say this is 90. So if I just run this program, then you will see that the first number is 90 and the second number is 10. As simple as it looks. Raising the level to the next. So now we have the function. So this is the function. Function that takes variadic parameter. Now you might have already experienced or used the usage. You might have used the variadic parameter in your favorite programming language. For let's say in Java you have the variadic parameter, in Scala you have it. So variadic parameters is a input parameter that is the collection. It's the infinite collection of the elements of a homogeneous set. So it is prefixed with three dots, and then a function with such a parameter is known as variadic function, and it may be invoked with zero or more arguments for that parameter. So over here the variadic parameter is numbers, variadic function is calculate group sum. So the intention is to pass the collection or the group of numbers like this and then calculate the sum. So what I will do in the caller is I will invoke this function. I will just open the bracket, close the bracket, and within the bracket I will just type the numbers that I just want to pass. By the way, as it takes the integer variadic parameter, note that I cannot pass string or something like that. I can just pass the integers. I have the capability not to pass any of the numbers over here. I can say that I just want to call it this function. So automatically the empty collection will be used under the hood. Now the interesting part over here is if I am not actually saying any composite data type or the complex data type, or let's say I am not using any slice, array or map, struct for that matter, then what is the underlying type? That's the most interesting question over here. And in order to find that type, I will use the printf capability of GoLang, and then I will make use of the %t, next line and numbers. So you will be amazed to know that it turns out to be the integer collection, and then it is nothing but a slice. So whenever I have the variadic parameter, the underlying type is the slice. As it is slice, I can make use of the for range operator, and then the intention is to calculate the sum by iterating over a slice. So that's why I will make use of the for underscore over here means I'm not intended to make use of the index, so that's why the underscore, so I don't have to use it somewhere, otherwise the compiler would throw the error, compilation error. Then the next is the value. Now I'm interested in this value, so I will range over the numbers. I will use this value in calculating the sum like this. And then last is you come out of the loop and then you have the sum of numbers in a slice. So you will see that it is 445. So these are the different flavors of the function in GoLang. One of the flavor or one of the aspect that is still not covered is the receiver part. I will cover it in a different video altogether. But now you know how to write a function, how to call that function, and then how to return the values from the function, and how to make use of the variadic parameter and variadic function in GoLang. Now with this knowledge, with the knowledge of if and else and switch and for, the identifiers, the comma okay operator or pattern, and now the function, it's time to write the sample application on your own in GoLang. Get your hands dirty, start coding in GoLang, write simple function, call them, use them, stack the functions together, see how do they work, and then grow your confidence so that you will be able to raise the bar to the next level. Because now we are done with the foundation of the GoLang. With this knowledge, you can understand any GoLang program, you can debug the program, and then now you can write your own program without referring to the any, let's say, Stack Overflow or Google, because now you have the sufficient knowledge or data with you to write simple application. So that's how you write the functions in GoLang. That's it for this session. See you in the next session.